All right, so that looks good. Is it going to project correctly? It is. All right, life is good. So, DNS security. Like I say, without DNS, by the way, if you're standing up, there's another stool up here you can take. Want another stool back there? Might as well, there's two more. You might as well have them. They're doing me no good up here. All right. So, you can communicate by typing in IP addresses. And if you do, by the way, you'll bypass an awful lot of security measures. But most people aren't willing to memorize the IP addresses they use, and they rely on DNS. So they type in alphabetical domain names, like ccsf.edu, and the online distributed network of DNS servers turns that into a number. And unfortunately, like all old internet protocols, this happens with no encryption, no authentication, no password, no verification. So in fact, all you really know is your computer sent out a request, which anybody could read, and somebody sent a reply, and you have no reason to believe it's the truth, and no reason it actually came from the people that claimed to send it. So it's very easy to fabricate these results. But that's the way it is, because the whole internet started by just writing protocols that were good enough to make it work at all, and nobody thought about security until decades later. So, there's a lot of attacks on DNS. Microsoft DNS servers were attacked in 2001 and many other times, just trying to take them offline as a stunt. The original denial of service attacks were just people trying to get attention by knocking down something important. And this led people to improve their DNS infrastructures. Instead of having just a single DNS server or a single router or switch it goes through, people realized that you have to have a decentralized architecture with multiple redundant servers, so if one goes down, the others can take over the load, because if you stop answering DNS queries, anybody that hasn't been to your site recently can't find it. Now, if someone has been to your site recently, then the DNS record will be cached, either on their machine or in their router or at a local server, and so they're all right. But at least, perhaps once a day, somebody has to actually go to your main server to find out where you are, and if your servers go down, all the people that haven't been there in a day can't find it. So here's another outage from 2004. There was a botnet. One of the earlier botnets was used to make a distributed denial of service attack where large numbers of machines all go to the same DNS server and bring it down. And again, that creates an outage. And in 2002, people decided to attack the root of DNS. DNS is a hierarchical system. There are 13 server clusters which form the root of DNS. That's called dot. It is the root of the whole system, and the only thing it has is a list of the 13 top-level domains, which are .com, .mil, .net, and so on. And so if you want to find something, you ask dot where, you want to find ccsf.edu, you ask dot where is edu, it tells you where edu is, you ask edu where ccsf.edu is, and now you know ccsf.edu server, you ask it where the server you're looking for is. That's the way you go if you are the first person to resolve any DNS after a server's restart. So if someone were able to take down the entire root of the system, then for a while, nobody would notice any problem because there's a cache. And they continue to use cache information, but eventually, after a couple of days, all the caches would be expired and the whole internet would be down. Nobody would be able to find .com or .net or .mil. So that's why there's 13 servers. They're clusters. They're geographically dispersed around the world. They use all different operating systems, and no one has ever taken them down with any attack, although there have been several attempts. And so they attempted to use an ICMP flood, attacking all 13 servers at once, and they were unable to take it down. Yeah?
Yeah, these 13 servers, are they all over the world? Or?
Yeah. Yeah, and they're each clusters, too. And some are Unix and some are other operating systems. So it's turned out to be extremely resilient. But when people attacked it, that motivated them to make it stronger. So in 2002, the original way they were protected was they were just vastly over-provisioned. If the servers had an average of 1,000 queries a second, they could handle 10,000 or 100,000. So they could handle a lot more traffic than they had to. That's the simplest way to protect yourself from DDoS, is to just over-provision, have far more power than you need. All right, but this was a short attack. In 2007, there was another one, an Asian attack on them. This was a gigabit per second per server, a bogus DNS request, and it brought down two servers because two servers had not configured Anycast. Now, Anycast is difficult to set up, but very powerful, and Anycast gives you, means you have an IP address. For example, Google's DNS server is 8.8.8.8. And what you can do is you can take multiple servers all around the world and put the same IP address on all of them. And you configure Anycast, and then when I try to go to 8.8.8.8, I'm not going to one server, I'm going to whatever the nearest 8.8.8.8 is. And I can have many of them everywhere. And this has the effect not only of spreading out the good traffic, it also spreads out the attack traffic. There is no way for an attacker to focus on one server. They have to attack them all, and their attack will be spread out among them all, and that turns out to be very effective. So, I don't want to make people stand up. You might go out and try to find a chair to borrow from someplace. Anyway, all right, so that's the game. Anycast is difficult to set up, but it protects many things, and it also protects Cloudflare, like I mentioned. Cloudflare does this for any website. They put a copy of your website on their server, so all their traffic goes to their proxy server, and their proxy servers are in about 20 data centers all over the world, and they're provisioned with Anycast. So the people in China go to the local Chinese proxy, the people in the South go to San Jose, the West they go to San Jose, the East they go to New York, and if any one of them goes down, without them doing anything, it automatically is rerouted by BGP to whichever server in the Anycast group is still up. So here's a graph of the traffic on the DNS route, and you see it's some servers actually stopped answering queries and turned red, but other servers didn't, and again, they only got a couple of the 13 servers to go down, and as long as one of them stays up, there'll be no effect on real DNS. Okay, no one has ever managed to take it down. Now, a DNS query is typically recursive. This is the normal way you configure your router, which means if you try to find out a server, it will go find it, which means if you do a normal query, I query usually my router. You buy a router at home, like a Linksys router, put it in your house. It's got a little tiny computer in there without much memory. It doesn't have any room even for a cache, but yet you set it as your DNS server. So you ask it, where is Google? It doesn't know. It goes and asks somebody else where Google is and tells you the answer. That's a recursive server. It goes and fetches the data from the DNS tree and hands it back to you. That's the most common query. So you do it with DNS delegation. All these servers cache content. So the root server knows where .com, .net, .edu, and all the other top-level domains are, and that's all it knows. So if you ask it where hills.ccsf.edu is, it says, well, I don't know, but you should ask edu. And when you ask edu where hills.ccsf.edu is, it'll say, I don't know, but I know what the authoritative server for ccsf.edu is, and you better ask them, and they can tell you about anything in the ccsf.edu domain. So that's how it works, and that's called DNS delegation. You ask it a question, and it doesn't know the answer, so it forwards you to another server, which will give you more information to forward to another, and eventually you get your answer. The problem is, all these servers cache records. Now, that is really important because people keep going to the same website over and over and over. Unthinkable millions of people are going to Google all the time. There is no real need to keep on asking the Google root server where it is. You just make local copies at every server of the cache you keep for some period of time, and you answer all the millions of questions with copied data. The problem is, what if you can modify the contents of the cache? There have been a bunch. There was a DNS cache poisoning attack in 2005, where what you could do is send an update to servers, since the authentication is very weak, and trick them into believing that you have the authority to tell them Yahoo has moved. And now all those servers, like tell the Verizon servers Yahoo's gone somewhere else, then put up a fake Yahoo page there with a fake login, and all the Verizon customers for a period of time will all be redirected to the fake site. And back in a time when almost nobody used HTTPS, there was really no way to tell that you were at a fake site. And this can be done on a local internet, like a coffee house. You can just put out fake DNS resolutions. They can do it by putting malware on your machine. They can do it by changing the host files or the DNS server on your machine. There are many, many ways to trick DNS into getting the wrong answer, and then it makes it easy to trick people and steal their data. And that was the attack called farming. Farming is where you infect a machine, get root privileges, and all you do is change the DNS server or put some entries in the hosts file, which is used instead of DNS to resolve some names. And now, all that happens, it has no effect on the machine that anyone notices, but the original attack I heard of was in Brazil. They attacked machines and they changed the DNS resolution of the most popular bank in Brazil. They go to a fake bank page. No apparent harm happens now, but later when you go to the bank, you'll be at the wrong bank and they'll get your banking credentials. And that's why they call it farming. Phishing, they have a hook. When you bite on the hook, you get infected with malware and a bad thing happens right away. But this is farming. You plant seeds and later money comes in. Anyway, DNS changer was the next big one in the same area. You get affected by this, and it would change your DNS resolving IP address to one of these hackers' control. So now, they control your DNS servers. They put up a DNS server full of mostly good data, but a few wrong records about banks or something of interest, and they can redirect all the affected machines to go to those sites. And this turned out to lead up to a big problem, because the FBI caught them and took down the servers, and then all the infected machines lost the internet because they were using those servers for DNS resolution. So the FBI had to get money and court permission to put up a good DNS server at that address, and they kept it up for about 2 years while they tried to reach all the infected people and say, clean off your machine, because taking down that server would end the internet for them, which is, and there were a lot of argument over whether they really should be doing that and who's gonna pay for that. Is that really in your authority? Is that really in your budget? And this, there have been many cases like that where the good guys try to stop something and it turns out to be very hard to decide whether they really have the right to stop it. One other thing Microsoft has done is find the command and control centers for botnets. So there's a million infected machines with some malware. They're all getting controls from a botnet. Microsoft is able to identify the botnet and take the control center and take it over. Now what can they do? Is it legal for them to send a signal from that to clean the malware off all the machines? Or is that a crime? Do they need a court order? Does somebody have the authority to issue that court order? There have been a lot of arguments about this, and Microsoft has done that a few times, but it's the legal status is very unclear. Like almost everything in the world of security, the laws are way behind, and most anybody doing something important in the world of security is breaking the law to some extent, and they have to have a legal team to help them dodge the risks. And then came Dan Kaminsky. This is what made Dan Kaminsky famous. He's the most famous ethical hacker in the world. He's local too in San Francisco. He's also a very nice guy. A lot of people throw mud at him because they're jealous, but I never heard anybody have any argument with him that really made any sense. He is much smarter than all the rest of us, and that could be humiliating, but that's the way it is. And so he figured out that he could poison DNS caches, and there was no flaw in the software. The protocol itself had a mathematical error that made it possible for him to poison the cache anywhere. And he managed to contact all the big companies like Microsoft and all the other companies that make DNS server software and secretly meet with them and secretly get them to patch it before it came out, and it was never used for any evil purpose. That is one of the very few cases I know of successful ethical disclosure. I've done a lot of this myself in much smaller, less important issues, and I have found that there's almost no vendor that could care less if they have a security flaw. They don't want to hear it, they won't do anything. All I do is wait 45 days or 30 days and then dump it publicly, because most vendors couldn't care less if they have a security problem. They don't have any department to handle it. Microsoft is one of the better ones, but he was one of the few cases where they really had an important vuln and they managed to fix it. Then, of course, there's DNS that is not directly the target of an attack, but it's part of an attack. Dynamic DNS. Let me see if I'm on the right file here, by the way. Oh, good, they're coming up. Good, all right. We do an iClicker soon. I have to hit the right button, though. In the original old days of DNS, you'd get warnings that if you make a change of your DNS server, like if you're using GoDaddy to host your website, you decide I don't like GoDaddy, I'm gonna move to something else, like 1&1, well, then you have to change your DNS record. So your whatever.com goes over here, and they'll warn you, for that to update, it might take like 6 hours. So for 6 hours, people will still be going to the old server instead of the new one. But nowadays, generally, it happens much faster, like within just a few minutes. So now there's fast flux DNS, where you just change the record very quickly. This is important for criminals, because when they set up a command and control server, they have to compromise a machine, put malware on it, and then it suddenly gets a ton of traffic. And before long, the owner notices, what is all this traffic? It's freezing up my network. And then they like turn off the machine or re-image it or something, and you lose it. So they have to keep moving forward. And even if the owner doesn't take it down, within a couple of days, if you're doing something like sending out spam, all the people are complaining, and people begin sending complaint letters back and forth, and sooner or later they get busted. So they hop from IP to IP, using one machine for only a few minutes, and then switching to another before someone takes that machine down. There's various versions of that. One of them is fast flux DNS, where you just keep moving your DNS around, and now it's very difficult for anybody to figure out where your real servers are, or to stop you, because they have to take down all those proxies, and since you're just stealing them, you steal some in China, and some in Japan, and some in America, and it's just some all over the place, some in Russia, so it's really hard for any legal entity to get court orders and police action as required to bring those things down. Anyway, now I got a few iClickers. If you haven't used these things here, you need to have a piece of paper with your name on it. If you have something, don't put a driver's license or a credit card or anything, because another student might take your card. Let me see if I can flip this thing open. If you don't have anything important, like a student ID, just write your name on a scrap of paper. I have a little scrap of paper here. Take out an iClicker and leave your name behind in the slot where it came out of. And you can earn extra credit by getting the most answers right on these iClickers. Okay. Oh, I should record the attendance too. Let me pass around a sheet for that. Please put your name on that and pass it around. All right. Good. This is ready. What's that?
Extra
syllabus. Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah. There they are. Good. Oh. You put them over, I guess. Yeah. Anybody else need the first day handout? Well, they're up here if you didn't get them. All right. Good. Get rid of this junk and this junk. All right. So, the iClickers. Turn them on with the power at the bottom. And then try voting. You should be able to see your vote take effect. And if you change from like A to B, it should hop around up here. All right. So turn it on, yep, and then hit one of those buttons and you should see an effect up here. If the light doesn't come on, let me know. That's a dead battery and I'll change it. But don't put driver's licenses or credit cards in there. Nothing valuable. Because students take each other's cards sometimes, and I do not have any way to prevent that. We're not fitting in here very well. I'll hunt around and try to get us a different room next time. I got a couple weeks. I can probably get us something. All right. So does everybody have an iClicker? Looks kind of like it. All right, let's try the real questions. All right, so which one of these will work without DNS? All right, I'll quit at 30 seconds. All right, and that's ping. The second one will work because that's an IP address. It doesn't need DNS if you actually know the IP address. All right. How about this one? If the root servers went down for an hour, what would you notice? What would happen? Quit at 30. All right, for almost everybody, everything would be fine because the only thing in the root servers is the location of .com and .net and .mil, and most everybody has that in caches. So most people would continue to use the internet with no problem for at least an hour. Really, probably about up to a day before anybody would start noticing a problem. All right. Which attack will only affect users with a specific ISP? Quit at 30. All right, and that's cache poisoning. if you poison the cache, it's only going to affect the users of that server, and most people just use the server that comes with your internet service. If you buy Comcast, use the Comcast server. If you buy Verizon, use the Verizon server. So if you were to poison one of them, it would only affect the customers of that one company, and probably only the customers in a geographic region, depending on which server you're poisoning. All right. Which one lets people host websites at home? I forgot to mention that earlier, but we'll see how many people know it out of general knowledge. I'll quit at 30. All right, and that's dynamic DNS. Yep, most people know it anyway. That's the most common use of it. If you want to host a website on a home machine and your IP address keeps changing, you go to their server and they keep track of your changing DNS and redirect traffic to it by constantly changing the record as needed. So you can host a machine without paying for hosting services from your ISP. As long as you don't get too much traffic, then they'll catch you. All right, which attack allows the attacker to reroute your traffic at will? I guess I can quit at 25. Looks like the answers are in. All right, and that's DNS changer, which changed your server to a server under their control, and they can then change the records anytime they want. Now, what I'm going to do now is let me stop the recording. I'll continue it later, but let me make a note. This is 40, chapter 1A. All right, and I'm going to go to the lab.